national scale. It'll be quite a challenge, but very interesting to see how it develops. Mm-hmm. You're coming into the department at a time the outgoing president, Noynoy Aquino, has vetoed a bill providing a salary increase for nurses. Mm-hmm. What do you plan to do with it?
Well, we will review it again, and of course, we were part of the team that actually supported its passage to in Congress and in Senate. But looking at, well, maybe the data that the president might have and reviewing it again. But suffice to say that the bottom line is for the DOH, we support salary increases, not just for nurses, but for all health professionals. And we'd like to also match that for pay for service. Like if they service more Filipinos or the ratio is greater, like more than 1:12 for nurses, then they should get higher pay. And we're thinking of difficult assignment pay, like if they're assigned in geographically isolated disadvantaged areas or conflict areas, they should have a difficult assignment pay add-on.
And you're also promoting universal health care through PhilHealth. You want to do three things here. You want to modernize, expand, and streamline. I mean, the issue over PhilHealth really is about the lack of funds. And while it's repeatedly been denied, doctors and nurses say this is a problem. How do you plan to attend to it?
The problem of PhilHealth is that, well, much of the funds actually go to the private sector, 70%, and only 30% to government hospitals and health facilities. So, and then there's also more for curative services and very little for preventive promotive services. So we want to shift that so that the burden for healthcare is actually released from the lower socioeconomic class, and then the upper socioeconomic class actually pays for the greater burden. So it will be socialized, it will be no balance billing for the poorest, and hopefully we have higher utilization and availment for the poorest Filipinos.
So what's your ideal ratio? Is it 60-40, 70-30?
Well, we hope to move it up to 70-30, meaning that 70% goes to public facilities and 30 to private facilities, and also the 60-40 in terms of public health, 40%, and 60% for curative rehabilitative care. So it's just a rough figure, but we'll try to balance all this and see how we can improve health financing in this country.
Well, let me pick up on facilities. You know, when we talk about PPP, we often, you know, talk about roads, bridges, and building infrastructure. But now it's going into the realm of healthcare. Mm-hmm. Would you be in favor of participating in public-private partnerships at the health department?
During the time of Secretary Ona, I was already assistant secretary, we had a PPP office, actually.
And at the DOH.
At the DOH. Mm-hmm. And we tried to explore projects with the private sector. I think there were a lot of problems because this was a very new thing for the health sector. But we're still in the process of developing that PPP office and exploring other possibilities with the private sector. For example, we're beefing up our program for travel medicine. So that would include the migrants' health, that would include retirement homes here and medical tourism, and also health of the refugees. I think it was mentioned last night in a program that we have more refugees, more migrants, and so we have to look at that, the health situation for these marginalized population groups.
So you see that medical tourism could be an opportunity for the Philippines, that it could become a hub here in the ASEAN, do you think?
Yes, that's where we see PPP can come in, and we see that investments will come in, for example, for retirement homes, for geriatric homes, hospice care, and our nurses who used to be going abroad for these types of services will be retained here in the country.
Have any of the private companies, the big companies here in the Philippines, come to the health department for such partnerships?
Actually, I was the point person for the Philippine Medical Tourism Program of the Department of Health, and we've had some exploratory talks on that.
Okay, and we'll get you up to speed on that. As you can see, the bell is about to be rung at the Philippine Stock Exchange, but I just want to put this in before I let you go, Secretary, about reproductive health, because really it's been a key item on the 10-point agenda. I mean, when I was talking to Pernia, he was telling me something about the 9 points in the economic agenda. It was just 8. Yes. It became 9 because of family planning. What does the DOH plan to do in terms of family planning?
Yeah, because we believe in the health sector that our economic gains will be negated if our population continues to increase. And, we have set up a strategy implementing the reproductive health law. And at present, we have 20% of women of reproductive age with unmet for family planning. And I think our priority would be to serve that 20% with unmet need to ensure that our women have the capacity, the knowledge, and the ability to space pregnancies and to limit pregnancies so that they can actively participate in economic activities and also help the family in improving their situation.
How much money is going into this family planning then?
I'm still not privy to that, but I'm waiting for the report, the second year report of the RHRP law implementation, and we'll look into that. And we have a chance right now. The president, the incoming President Duterte, was telling us that the 2017 budget will be resubmitted to Congress. So we have a clean slate to actually move the budget to priority projects like the reproductive health implementation.